this is some really exciting science that's going on here. It's just science. Without any further ado, I want to introduce David Spurkle, who's a cosmologist from Princeton University. David is a member of the Space Studies Board, and in July will be our new chair of the Space Studies Board, and Charlie Kent, our other chair, is asking to introduce our speakers. And so, David.
It's a great pleasure to get to introduce Sara Seager. This is the first of the Space Week public lectures. And I think the Space Science Space Studies Board could not have picked a better speaker to start with. I had the pleasure of knowing Sara since she was a postdoc at Princeton. At the time, she was one of the real pioneers, one of the first people to really think deeply about exoplanet atmospheres. And this is at a time in which even very few exoplanets and almost nothing in the way of observation other atmospheres. After her postdoc at Princeton, she moved here to the DC area, where she was at DTM near Carnegie, and then moved back to Boston, where she would start at. She was a PhD student at Harvard. And joined the faculty at MIT, and she's now a professor there. As you'll hear, Sara is really at the forefront of research in exoplanets. She's a co-author of TESS, a very exciting mission that will discover, we hope, many planets around the nearest stars. She's a real visionary in the field. We just heard from Sara about some of her work on developing cultures, thinking about ways in which we can detect planets around nearby stars and really begin to characterize them. Sara's been recognized for this work with a number of prizes, including the Sackler Prize, and most recently the MacArthur Fellowship, the MacArthur Genius Award. And I think you're all in for a real treat hearing Sara describe the exciting progress and possibilities in this field. Sara.
One is that I have a new format of talk here, it's called Prezi, so pay attention and see if you like it. The second point I want to mention, since David mentioned Princeton, was back in those days, it was a pretty awesome time for exoplanets. So few people worked on it, but there was really no pressure to be mainstream in any way. And all the meetings with David and the people at Princeton, there was only one rule, which was unspoken, and that was you did not use the word no. So you'd say, well, this bird will people, can we see lightning? On an exoplanet far away, you see this, you see that, and it generated this real spirit of adventure. And that's all I always remember about my favorite time at Princeton. So now, here's the start of the talk. I hope that you all, I hope everyone here has been to a dark sky. Can I see show of hands, because I bet there's a lot of the stars in here. Whenever I go to a dark sky, I always wonder, I always look at the stars. I actually can do this from a not dark sky, where you can see any stars at all. And I wonder if there's people or beings around those planets, around those stars, looking back at us, wondering if there are people here within them. So here today, the title of my talk is Exoplanets and the Real Search for Alien Life. So every star in the sky is a sun. And if our sun has planets, we should naturally expect that other suns or stars have planets also, and they do. And we can say now, statistically speaking, that every star in our Milky Way galaxy should have at least one planet. And not only that, but we have found so many planets out there that really it is just unbelievable. And I'm going to walk you through some of my favorites. First, I'm starting out with this part of the solar system, just to remind you about our own planetary system. It's got in the middle, the four terrestrial planets, Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars, and here's from Jupiter. And Saturn and the other planets would be much further out. So one of the, I think all of you must have heard from last week, about the new Kepler planets. Here's a animation of one system. Just bear with me. This is showing you Kepler 296. The green area I had mentioned is the so-called habitable zone, the zone around the star where a planet that resided and was being heated by the star would be not too cold, not too hot, but just right for life. Can you see all the planets zooming around here? They're zooming to scale. And now the system is tilting, and it's going to go to a scale version of how these planets look while they're going in front of their star, as seen from the telescope. In this case, the system is lined up just so, so that all of these planets, each one of these five planets in the system, goes around the star. And what's so interesting to me about this planetary system and others like it is all of the planets, we call it this a, it sounds a little technical, but a compact multiple planet system. And what we mean by that is that there are several planets. You can see here, they're all orbiting quite close to the star. There are some examples, like the first of its kind that was discovered, Kepler 11, that has five planets all orbiting interior to what would be Mercury's orbit. So many planets. And do you think these planets would all be like Mercury, like rocky small planets? No. Some of them are twice the size of Earth, massive enough that they must have big gas envelopes. So there's so many of these planets, these compact multiple object systems, that someone from the Kepler team made a movie of them. And we call this the Kepler orbit. It's made by Professor Dan Fabry from Chicago. Take a look at that. You can see our solar system, I believe, is the one up here. And it's showing you to scale. See how the ones at the center are moving quite quickly? These ones are quite far further out. It's showing you just a subset of the hundreds and hundreds of multiple planet systems scanned by a Kepler space telescope. The size of the object is supposed to represent the size of the planet relative to each other. But it's just showing you that nature has really provided for us in terms of just the sheer number of planets out there. So many planets. Another one of my favorite types of planetary systems are, we call them the, we have to make nicknames for all these planets. This one is called the hot super Earths. And here's a movie showing you the first hot super Earth planet, it's also called Kepler 10b. And this is showing you a star, like our sun. We don't see any other stars spatially resolved like this. They're all point sources of light. But in this example, we're seeing artist conception, a movie, an animation, as if we were in a spacecraft flying towards the system. And if we could get really close to this particular planet called Kepler 10b, it's a little bigger than Earth, it orbits so close to the star that its 1 year is actually just 0.85 days, less than 1 day. And what you're seeing on this planet here is that it's very, very hot on one side, heated by the star, very cold on the other. What's happening is that this planet is so close to the star that we believe it's tidally locked. It's showing the same face to the star at all times, just like the moon does to Earth. And it's so hot, it would be heated to maybe 2,000 degrees Kelvin or hotter, that the atmosphere may have been totally evaporated. What the artist is showing here is, it's actually a friend of mine, his name is David Berry. He's making this animation showing you, like, almost like a comet tail, a very weak comet tail of particles like silicates, rocky material coming off of the planet's surface. And now as we're zooming into the planet, as if we could go there, you will start to see lava lakes, not created by volcanoes, but we believe these would be present based on just being heated from the star. So heated from the star so much that the surface would be hot enough to melt rock. And that's what we're showing here. And I'll let you enjoy this animation to see just how great it is. So one of the more fun parts of my job is consulting with the animators. They don't always listen, of course. I think I have to take a little digression here and tell you about one of my most recent adventures where we wanted to know what would a lava planet look like. Because we can't, as scientists, we don't get movies like this. We're not going to the planet and take your movie. We'd like to know what a spectrum of lava looks like. And I don't know if you'll believe it or not, but I looked very hard for a few years, and people at the university checked it, and we didn't find any spectrum of lava, so we decided to take one ourselves. And it may sound like it's an excuse for a trip to Hawaii, but in Hawaii, when I was there, it was when sequestration was happening and the parks weren't open, and I didn't have great equipment, and that didn't happen. But we discovered that people make artificial lava. And they do this in the lab at MIT in small crucibles where they're trying to study how material behaves underneath the surface. They do it in Syracuse, actually. They make lava for art and science, and they have like melt flows that put into water tanks to see how the ocean is just forming, things like that. And then we found that after making a trip to Syracuse with our equipment, that even MIT and Foundry, they're melting. So we're trying to get a spectrum. I'll have to report to you back on that later. Okay, so I'm just going through all the different types of planets. I have a few more here in this stuff too. We have these other planets we call mini Neptunes or sub-Neptunes. Here I'm showing you a real image of Neptune, and here's a hollow image of Earth. So our Neptune is about four times the size of Earth. And in our solar system, we thought we had most things pretty much understood. until Kepler telescope and other telescopes found a whole new class of planets we had never dreamed of. And these we call the mini-Neptunes or the sub-Neptunes. And this artist's conception is perfectly that world, because we don't know what it's made of. We don't know what they're made of. There's a huge number of them, and they're hyper-density. And they're about 2 to 3 times the size of Earth's size. Now, why we don't know what they're made of? Because we can imagine what they could be, right? But we come up with more than one option. And so far, having a size and a mass, we can't discriminate among these things. When we hope it is, we always hope for the most exciting and exotic type of planet is a water world. Imagine a planet that is a scaled-up version of one of Jupiter's icy moons. That's 50% water by mass, for example. Could be a planet like that. It could be actually like a Neptune, but it's the end down. But what's so interesting is that astronomers actually don't know how these work. We have a tiny planet formation theory, we had one, where planets will start accreting mass, and they'll get massive enough so that then there's a runaway process where the planet will suck in all the material surrounding it from its so-called heating zone, and will grow in a runaway process until it becomes a giant planet. And that was the basic picture we carried with us. But these so-called mini-Neptunes don't do that. They're somehow stalled out. And we don't have a great picture of how Neptune formed. It was kind of contrived, and it doesn't match for these mini-Neptunes. But what is so fascinating about them, and if there's only one thing that you can remember from my talk, that you can take away and tell your children or your class or people you know who are teachers, it's that these planets, these so-called mini-Neptunes, are actually among the most common planets in our entire galaxy. And they're 10 times more common than Jupiter-sized planets. And what's showing you, this is actually my only graph of the talk, so you don't have to understand this talk to understand the rest of the talk, is showing you a fraction, in fact, it's showing you a fraction of stars and planets. In fact, this doesn't really matter, it's just the relative size of ours. But it's showing you planet size relative to Earth here. So this would be 1 times the size of Earth. Over here, we have Jupiter, which is about 11 times the size of Earth. And these 2 to 3 times the size of Earth planets here, they're just so popular, they're more common than Jupiter's. And this is for a certain type of orbit and a certain type of star, but actually we find through other techniques, the microlensing and the velocity addition to transits. But this seems to be true across the board, that small planets are much, much more common than large planets. So that's one of the main takeaways from today. So, okay, one thing I want to mention here is how these planets were discovered by Kepler. This is showing you the transit maker, the transit detection techniques, where in the artist's conceptions, we always show the picture, because that's what you understand. But in science, we only make this measurement here. We only see stars as points of light. And you can see here the star is approximately constant brightness until the planet goes in front of the star and the starlight drops until the planet goes in the other, passes away from being in front of the star. And it's this characteristic drop in brightness that we're looking for, that Kepler's telescope and thousands of planet candidates and hundreds of confirmed planets using that transit technique. So that was my basic introduction, the fact that there are so many planets out there of all different kinds. Nature has basically shown that planet formation is a random process. You can get pretty much any type of planet you can imagine within the laws of physics and chemistry will actually exist. But the types of planets people really care about, so I can talk about the other stuff for days, and I find out that from my friends and colleagues and public, people don't even really care that much, no matter how exciting they are. We all just really want to know, is there another Earth out there? And that's what the rest of my talk is about. So, just like the concept we fixate on, I see some prime master biologists here in front of the room. So we always talk about water. All life on Earth requires liquid water. So our conservative, easy thing to do is to look for planets that we think would have liquid water. Now, planets like Earth that are rocky with thin atmospheres, they're heated by the star. The atmosphere plays a greenhouse role. But on the whole, they're heated by the star. And so we can concoct the distance from the star, this is green zone, where the planet is heated to the right temperature. Not too hot, not too cool, but just right for life. And just as an aside to my professional colleagues here, do not believe how agitated the professionals get about defining the so-called habit zone. And one of my postdocs, his name's Andres Song, he worked hard to come up with what is the most inner edge to the habit zone that it could be. And it turns out that the greenhouse gases are a big issue, right? And it turns out that on our planet, in fact, water vapor is our biggest greenhouse gas. We don't care about it as often as carbon dioxide and methane, because we can't control it. We don't control the water cycle. Like, we're not pumping in extra water to our atmosphere. But it turns out that it's such a big greenhouse effect that if we had less water, the planet could be closer to the star. And if there's a complicated feedback cycle one has to worry about, but he came up with the result that a habitable planet like Earth could actually get 0.5 AU. And that doesn't mean that the external culture and the entropy of the final suns. It's much harder to get to half of AU. But, you know, we want to extend our zone. We don't want to miss planets. It could happen just because we were so fixated on Earth. But for what it's worth, we have the habitable zone, and we'd like to know if there are planets there or not. And what is so cool is that today we have a bunch of, we call them potentially habitable planets. And there's actually a website you can go to, and you can Google potentially habitable planets. They come up with this description, they try to assign probability to it. And this is just artist conceptions. We don't have any pictures of exoplanets that look like this. But you can see here, there's a bunch of them. They have different names, they're all discovered by different techniques. So despite having all of these and having so many potentially habitable ones, it turns out we don't know for sure if any of them really can support life or not. And I have a journalist who wrote this really funny story once, and this was quite a long time ago now, a news article, and it said, an Earth-like planet has been found, again, and again, and again. Because we're constantly hearing in the news that we have found one, all it means is that a planet in a star's habitable zone has been found. But some of these planets are quite big, and really it's this whole greenhouse effect that is a controlling factor to the surface. So we really do want a way to look at the atmospheres to try to understand how hot the planets are and whether or not their surfaces could be suitable for life or not. But in my mind, the fact that there are at least 12 things that we can say could be potentially habitable is a very big deal. In exoplanets, when there's one, there's always more. And it's just the tip of the iceberg. It's like as if you wandered in the desert and you saw an oasis, it looked like there was water there, but you started seeing it all over the place. And then there was real water. And eventually, you know you're going to come to the big lake, and that would be coming to the day when we just find habitable planets are everywhere. So we don't know of any yet. We don't have enough information. But we are starting to suspect that those planets are out there. Okay, so now I come to the part about how do we find and identify habitable planets. Well, there are several ways to do this. There are two ways to do this. And one of these ways is by looking for small planets that transit small stars. This is the transit technique, and we actually sometimes call them super-Earths, orbiting small stars. To find these planets are relatively easy to find and identify using today's technology. So here's an artist's conception showing the planet going in front of the star and one going behind the star. And from this method, actually, we can learn a huge amount about the planet. When the planet goes in front of the star, we can measure the size of the planet compared to the size of the star. And if we know the size of the star, we can get the size of the planet. And we found the sizes of hundreds or even over 1,000 planets this way. You can see the secondary eclipse when the planet's thermal radiation disappears and reappears. And in this case, we can learn about the planet's temperature in its atmosphere. And for this artist's conception here, I want to mention that we're not seeing the star planet like this. All we're seeing is a point source of light. The planet and star are blended together in their light. And it's like the animation I showed you with the curve, that we're watching what happens as a function of time. And I want you to know that almost all exoplanet atmospheres have been studied in this way, with the Hubble Space Telescope, the Spitzer Space Telescope, and the ground-based telescopes. And we looked at about 3 dozen or 4 dozen exoplanet atmospheres in this way, sometimes just in a few different wavelengths. For about 5 of them, we have very detailed measurements. And I guess it's sort of good news and bad news, but a lot of it doesn't make too much sense. You sort of would like to have a problem that's clear cut that you can predict in advance. But on the other hand, it's sometimes better if it doesn't turn out as a theory. And one of the objects that's, I've learned actually from being a part of this field and now being slightly outside of it, how much people fight about stuff. So it depends on where you work and what your job is, but people are fighting unbelievably over data for whatever our best plan is. It's called NEAS 1214b. It's one of these so-called mini Neptunes transiting a small star. And it turned out that after so much hard work, we wanted to know what is the number of something, is it mini Neptune, is it like a water world, or is it something else? And we had a great shot at being able to decide if it was a water world or if it was indeed something else. But in this case, nature didn't cooperate, and essentially it gave us a featureless spectrum, essentially just a straight line. And some people think it's just blanking with clouds. It's so cloudy, and the clouds don't have spectral features, so you can't sample the atmosphere underneath the clouds. But this is something that initially, I'm just going to give you a little aside here, that when you're working at the edge, the frontier of the field, and your instruments weren't totally designed to do what you need, you often see, some of you know what I'm talking about, you often see like signal and noise, but it's not really there. And we were very excited because with Hubble data and others, it really looked like there was a water feature. I remember one of my students had to really try to beat it home to him that it could be anything really. That's why you call it super-gate sigma, it's like not necessarily anything. But he was still able to demonstrate his thesis. Thank you, Dr. Becky, that he heat actually helps the whole atmosphere for treatment method and demonstrated we would need 10 Hubble orbits, a lot of time in the Hubble Space Telescope to get, actually not 10, more than that, to get 10 transits to really see whether that feature was real or not. It turned out after all that effort, it was Jacob Bean at Chicago who led this effort for the observations, it turned out it just showed basically a feature was spectrum. So just like we had, before exoplanets became a big deal, it would be a cosmology, so we have a, we're not picking up the cosmologists on purpose, it's just, it would be the data and the theorists who work so hard, there'd be millions of papers, and we're sort of seeing the same thing here. We have a lot of theories of what this planet could be, and people come up with extreme theories of this carbon monoxide planet, maybe it's pure carbon monoxide, which you laugh as you think about planetary planets, or maybe it's just as really cloudy, or maybe it has no atmosphere at all. So we're working hard on that. So what's really great about this is that we're going to have a chance to find many, many, many more of these 12, 14 B type of objects, which are just transiting planets. And that is with the test transiting exoplanet survey satellite. An MIT-led NASA mission, and George Rinker, the PI of this, is sitting right here in the audience. He's in the front row here. And he talked about that a little bit earlier today for the CAA. So here you can see the test spacecraft. It's about the size of a big washing machine that this model participate. And it has these cameras, four of them, you can see them all attached to the same platform. And it's going to cover a very wide field of view on the sky. Each camera is 24 by 24 square degrees. And what test is going to do is going to do an all-sky survey. 2 years, and hopefully it'll be extended for longer, running in the northern hemisphere, running in the southern hemisphere, looking at 500 million, it's going to look at, I guess, a million stars. It's, the numbers always like to change, but it's going to look at many, many, many stars all across the sky, looking for transiting exoplanets. And while TESS will find thousands of new planets, the ones we're really excited about are the small rocky planets transiting the M stars. Now, these M stars are lower luminosity than the sun, and so they have the so-called haplosis is quite close to the star. And so the periods are shorter, but to make a long story short, it just makes it much more favorable for detection. And what we plan to do is, we already know the statistics that these planets are common, and we'll plan to pull a short period of rocky planets transiting small stars, and we'll follow up their atmosphere observations of the James Webb Space Telescope. So instead of describing the models and the technical details on the follow-up, let me take you on a virtual trip to one of these exoplanets that's orbiting a small star. And in particular, this is an artist's conception of a transiting planet in the habitable zone of a small star. So if we were to be able to travel to that planet, here's what we think we would see. First of all, the sun would be very big in the sky. It would fill a lot of your sky. And here the artist has shown another planet that looks like a moon. Here's another transiting planet in the same system. And here the artist took, this is one of the artists that did for me. License to just make the sky an interesting color. But what's really interesting to me about this type of planet is that it would be tidally locked to its host star, showing the same face of the star at all times, just like the moon does to Earth. But what this would mean for us is that if we were at this planet, is that, approximately speaking, the star would be in the same part of the sky at all times. So this means you could choose where to live on that planet. Would you want to live where it's always daytime? Or if you're an astronomer, you want to go to where it's always night. Or you could go to vacation where all of the sun is always night. Another thing is your year would be quite short. These planets maybe have 10 to 50 days of half in the star. And so what I always tell if there are kids in the audience, I don't see them here right now, but they say, that would mean is that your birthday would be every 15 days. And the kids always laugh, and the parents kind of roll their eyes if you're planning a party every 15 days or so on. But on the other hand, it may not be so great to live on one of these planets, actually. Because these M stars are quite active. A lot of them, even the so-called quiet ones we've seen, even in the Space Telescope, they'll be long flares, or they're much more active than our sun. And in ultraviolet wavelengths, they may be quite active. So they may be giving off rays. You could be using your cell phone or electronics. The daytime may be dangerous for mutations. We don't really know. And it's sort of one of the things we're going to wait and see what happens. We know that even the current M stars that have transiting planets are somewhat variable. We're able to work around that in terms of getting atmospheric spectra. And at this point, I do want to mention one more little story here. And that's about the chance for finding signs of life with the test James Webb Space Telescope set up. Because I did title the talk, "Real Search for Alien Life." And what I meant by that was not, it wasn't the search for UFOs, like some people actually asked me about. But it's actually the search in terms of the search for biosignature gases. On a planet far away, what we'd like to do is study the atmosphere and identify the gases in the atmosphere. And on our own planet, some of those gases are produced by life. oxygen, ozone's a byproduct. We have many, many, many other gases. In fact, what I discovered, I think in fact I'll sort of go later, what I discovered kind of as an other is that in our, it's not a discovery, right, because it already exists, but in our own atmosphere, all of the gases that are present to the one part of 10 million level that are not the Earth gases like argon or helium, they're actually all produced by life. And they're all naturally occurring also, like nitrogen is naturally occurring, but they're all also produced by life. So there's a vast array of gases produced by life. It's just a burden on us to figure out in what cases we'd be able to identify those as being produced by life. Usually we just miss so much of that gas that it's out of equilibrium and has to be produced another way. So what I did was, I don't have this story here, but this can summarize it verbally. For another colleague, it was his birthday. They had a birthday celebration for us, but they do when you turn 70. and I entitled the talk the revised Drake equation. And what I did was I took the terms from the Drake equation, wrote them all down to offer up what is the chance that we will find signs of life on a planet with the James Webb Space Telescope and test combination. Now it turns out, just like with the Drake equation, the first few terms will be something you can quantify. How many M stars are there? What is the fraction of small planets in the habitable zone of M stars? We know those already. You can sort of work through the first few. But the second few terms are all speculative. It would be what are the chances that life arise? If life arises, what are the chances that we produce biosimilar gases? And the reason I haven't written a paper on this yet is because the right way to do this each term has to be a probability, not just a number, because you have to actually do it right. And so the final answer is that, unfortunately, there is no real answer, because the last few terms are speculative. But we can say that if every planet, if every M star had, if every M star, well, we know the frequency of habitable, we know the frequency of rocky planets in habitable zone. We can say that if all planets had life on them, all ones that could have life did have life, and if half of those that had life produced the spectroscopic signature we can see, then we actually have a real shot at finding signs of life on a planet with the James Webb Space Telescope. Okay, so you didn't have to then process all that, because I didn't say we guaranteed to find it. I said everything worked in our favor, that the numbers, you know, the number that life always arises and that half of that life has spectroscopic signature, we have a great shot at it. So TESS was never designed to do this. Basically a bogus outcome. It's the concept that we know how to study atmospheres, we're working on hard how to recognize gases that don't belong or could be attributed to life, and that TESS and the James Webb are geared up to study very small objects. So now we move on to the topic I'm most excited about, and I'm really glad to get to give you the colloquial version of this, because earlier today I gave the full problems report on starshade, and I see there's some team members here. I don't think someone raised their hands, but I can see it. It's Keith and Steve. Gary here, and I pointed out to anyone who's worked on related concepts in the past, I think there's others here. And this is the idea of how do we actually look at the true planet? Because what I told you about was the M star version. And that's akin to, let's say you go out and you do 23, I actually did 23andMe, and it ends up telling you all about all your relatives, like the ones that you had a common ancestor 300 years back. So I see that the M star piece is like, you'll have as well this person is my fourth cousin who, I don't know them, this is a different language than the country. And I see the Earth twin. That's like finding out that you had a twin sibling separated at birth, and all of a sudden you can't be your twin. So we do have a big difference here, where we're doing tests, this is the right thing to do now, we want to find these planets that are easy to find, we're eager to know if there are planets to find them. But ultimately, all paths lead to looking for the Earth twin. And that's the topic that I'm going to talk about next. Okay, first I think it was this one, one more funny story though. Before I came here, I was busy this weekend, but before that I was working very hard on an intro report. We were trying to get all wrapped up, at least our draft version by on Friday. So I told my two kids, look, it's not always that I can actually choose to write this report. She said, what is the path to her? It takes a while. And I said, well, then maybe it would be one of you. And again, if you have children here, I said, maybe it's one of you. That really just opened their eyes that, it's in our power to actually try to find another planet on the Earth. And it may be that the person who ends up making it really happen to go over the edge is the person that's TBD. I think all of us here, and I see many people who really are playing a real role here, have a chance to do it. And before I move on to this back part of my talk, I want to say we're all working hard on this. And we all believe that whether it's you have to have your first or the internal chronograph or what they call the external chronograph of starshade, We all have a shot at finding Earth, and each one of these has a chance to do it. But in this generation, we're just going to find it if we're lucky, if it's true nature provided and put an Earth around most stars, which we believe is true. We'll find one or two of them. We'll 3 or 4 or 5. But I think the real search lies in the future, when we figure out how to put the huge American space, and we can look at, we want to look at thousands of stars, we don't do that many, to find hundreds of Earths to find signs of life. Not so that it'll be very now for the people who are the generation of the 10-year-old children today who will be able to find it. So now I'm going to move on to tell you after that, like, sorry, how hard the problem is and what we're doing to try to reach it. And here's the artist's conception of another Earth and of a star. See, you can't really see the star here, they're just showing the glare. That's effectively our problem, that the Earth that we want to find is not so super faint. It's quite faint. It's faint, like the faintest galaxies Hubble has ever observed. But it's right next to a bright star. And our sun and star combination, our sun is 10 billion times brighter than our planet. So in order to find the Earth, you have to block out the starlight to one part of 10 billion, or actually move it better. And so think about what field you're working if it's something that you have to do precision measurements. And now work out to 10 decimal places and think about if that's actually achievable. And we're compounded by, being limited by the laws of, well, we all are compounded by, being limited by the laws of physics, in this case it's diffractive light, and by the finite wavelength of light that we want to look at. So this is a very hard problem. These planets are extremely challenging to identify. But that's what we're here today, three different groups reporting on how we're going to do that. And how we want to do this, there are many ways to do it, I'm going to talk about one. And that's what we call the starshade. It's the starshade telescope system. We're a very specially shaped screen that's tens of meters in diameter, flies with the telescope, space telescope, and blocks out the starlight so that only the planet light hits the telescope. Now this starshade, the telescope has to be so precisely aligned that it's like asking a friend to hold up a dime at 5 miles away and to line it up. So this is not easy to do, things have to be far away and spread out precisely, but it's something that's actually being worked on right now. And just by the way, one more thing that I wanted to mention about the analogy of looking for the planet next to the star, the sunlight star, that's like looking for a firefly next to the searchlight, when the firefly and searchlight are both 20 micrograms distance. That's like looking from here in Washington, trying to see a firefly next to a searchlight that is across the country on the west coast. So I added a cartoon diagram here to explain why the star shape works in a special shape. And here you're seeing a circle. This would be a circular screen in space, or a square would be a circle. And if you have a star that's a point source in the background, you block out the starlight. Contrary to what your intuition might tell you, you will block out the light. Actually, you'll get this ring pattern. And this actually has a lot of scales that can show up here. You get a ring pattern called area rings. This is your focus to track the light. You can think of this analogously like dropping a pebble in the pond where you see ripples. Drop a pebble in the pond and there's ripples. But this first ripple of light is from the starlight diffracting around the edges of the screen. The first ripple actually would be 100,000 times brighter than the planet you're looking for. And so that's a problem because even if you had a perfect telescope that could kind of look at these black spots here, it wouldn't. So what happened was actually started with this verbal pupil and a flurry of mathematical activity. People realize that you can actually have a very special shape instead of a circle. You can have a shape like this. This is an older version of it. It's essentially like a flower with a central circle and then kind of petals all around the outside. And what you end up doing here is the diffractive light and the quick source behind that screen. It ends up looking like this, where you have all the scattered light that's heading towards the edges. There are other designs out there that get rid of this as possible. And what this would be equivalent to, that's like dropping the pebble in pond. And instead of seeing ripples, it's actually perfectly smooth from one part of 10 billion. And instead, all of the edges far away from you, there's a crazy ripple that happens. That's the way the starshade works. It's a very special design that's been worked on. And what's fascinating to me is that actually there's a paper about this in 1985 by a French optical physicist. It was actually motivated by Hubble space telescope. You know, now we can look at Hubble because of the gravity gradient of Earth and its equal orbit. It's something on that people can work out mathematically. So that's an important point, that the star shape has to be a special shape, and when it's manufactured and deployed, it has to be in a certain very special position. So tight tolerances will actually work. So now I'm going to show you a movie about the star shape. This is an animation made at JPL, showing you the telescope, and here's the telescope, the spacecraft bus, and this is the Apollo, all folded up. And these would launch together and separate on orbit, with the petals synchronously unfolding and furled, and the truss in the center expands and the petals of the snap into place. These tolerance here is capable of passing you to tens of microns and deploying to you hundreds of microns in terms of their relative position. This star shape is also will separate from each other to tens of thousands of kilometers, where that star shape would lock out the starlight and reveal it within planets. So that's the basic concept of behind the star shape. And there are a lot of different technical tall poles that are essentially all of them are being worked on right now. But the one that I just speak to is actually the deployment. How is this being deployed? How is it being tested in the lab? And here's another movie from JPL. It's JPL Princeton Olympic Project, showing you star shape deployment for technology and demonstration. So now you'll see the four prototype petals that are going to unfurl passively from their start position. And there's four because it's enough to test the interfaces between them and as attached to the truss. You can see one holding here and almost sealed on. And here's the centralized truss, which actually is left over at Northrop Grumman from large radio deployable communications that have been sent to space. Now you're seeing the second stage of deployment in the time-lapse video that's sped up by about a factor of two, where you're seeing now the petals, the truss expanding and pushing the petals into place. People always ask me why the people in here. But the point wasn't to demonstrate the automatic deployment. The point is to demonstrate that the petals can deploy to the position that's required. And it was tried 25 times to show that it's possible. So I hope you like those videos. I think to see that there's real technology, that there's a real concept, there's real technology demonstration happening. And that is moving this concept forward. Okay, so now I'm going to get us to what we're going to do when we find that building block. And here's where I hope there's a little bit of illustration for some of you here. But this here is actually a real picture of what we hope to find, the field of God. This is a real picture of Earth as taken from the Voyager 1 spacecraft from 4 billion miles away. I hope that you don't see it in the picture. It's a field of God. It's one of those things. What I like about this is, see this red marker? It's actually scattered light with the camera optics, but it resembles something that we think we would see, and that is zooms of light and dust. In our own asteroid belt, in our own solar system, the asteroids grind together, it's light, they generate dust. And this dust actually, for some of us, is a source of noise. For others, you can look for even signs of planets or interesting things happening in the remnants of that dust. But here, one of the things that we actually see, we don't see it, but you're worrying about it, it's one of those things we brush into the record and don't worry about it, it should. Because we don't know the other solar systems, maybe they have a bigger asteroid number, a denser one, maybe they have more asteroid and dust and it will create noise and prevent us from finding planets. There's other studies going on now observationally to try to make sure that nearby star systems aren't overwhelmed by dust. Another problem we have is working with Venus Earth. I didn't have time to talk about this earlier today, we'll see the paper dot, but we need to make sure we know what it is. We could have actually a planet that's masquerading as that paper dot, maybe from background galaxy or background star. Maybe it's a very, very dark Jupiter, a big planet that's very dark instead of a small planet that's very bright. And so a lot of the attention of myself and other people on the starshade team now is trying to make sure that we're able to identify what the planet is. It's going to be a blue dot. Well, the pale blue dot may be a different color. But we need to really work hard to understand what all the options are going to be. Now, we're confident that we're going to find those planets, that they're common, and that we'll find them. And then the question is, what do we do with them? And here's what I'll tell you a little bit about what I've been working on in the last year or so. And that's the search for biosymmetry gases. We want to find signs of life by looking for gases in a planet atmosphere, gases that don't belong. Now, in our own, we tend to be very geocentric here, because I don't know about the rest of astrobiology, but in exoplanets, we're very fixated on Earth. It's hard to concoct a scenario that you can make conclusive principles and convince yourself that there's life that does one thing or another. But we do know that all life on Earth uses chemical energy. We store these chemicals to store energy and release energy. In many, many metabolic processes, gases are released. And our best example on Earth is oxygen. It's produced by plants and photosynthetic bacteria. It fills our atmosphere to 20% of our volume and actually shouldn't be here in our atmosphere at all. If we had no plants and photosynthetic bacteria, we would have like maybe 10 orders of magnitude less oxygen, essentially negligible. And so that's a unique case. It's a highly reactive gas. But we're quite confident that if we see oxygen somewhere else, we're maybe confident that we know the different scenarios that can produce oxygen that are not from life, and that we can assess all of those situations. So ultimately, we wanted to look for oxygen ozone. But it turns out that, you know, our Earth, if we had oxygen ozone, would maybe half or less than life. So we don't want to be so terracentric that we actually find that field out. Remember I told you in our generation we may find 2 or 3 or 10 Earths? We wouldn't want to not find signs of life just because we didn't know what we were looking for. And so that was my main motivation for research over the last, it turns out it took like 5 years now. I was working hard to try to determine which gases it could be. And so then I actually came across the theory. It turned out that it wasn't right, but it's, you know, for astrophysicists here, I'm sure they could get emails from people with crazy theories. A lot of them like, well, the thing was here, I was the person with the crazy theory. And I went to one of my colleagues, Jack Shostak, who's a friend of the desert, he's in books in astrobiology, he's the professor from us. I had my 2 astrobiology, my 2 biochemistry colleagues, and I told him about my theory at the dinner, and I said, I'm going to talk to you. It was weird to be on the other side, because I felt like I was kind of a tank theorist, but I was pretty sure I was right. But it turns out it's what knowledge you have. And these people who write books about the tank theory, it's based on their knowledge, it may be self-consistent. But, you know, self-consistently wrong, because we have all the answers. So my theory, I cannot know. I already told you this long, but I liked it to mind. It was that also, that life produces all small molecules. So I was thinking of the funnel, though, for if I can imagine all small molecules that are stable and volatile, and then put different filters on them. I was hoping eventually to come up with a laundry list of molecules that I can give to the people doing the studies, the pro-class studies with the lab to person, whatever the teacher of the big telescopes in space, because they hear the molecules you really need to look for. And we want to be sure we don't miss the time of life. So all I wanted was molecules that are stable and volatile, that didn't happen to have the geophysical plus positive. We can actually estimate the biomass for different types of molecules, that's what I published on recently. And that again, maybe has some predictions. So in the midst of doing all of this, I ended up getting into this big data problem. And in this case, I wrote a chemical complement torque for all the big 6 biochemistry elements, hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, and phosphorus. And I ended up writing molecules in this 10, and I said, are can they exist on these stages? That second part's very hard to answer. If you want to answer that from first principles, it's like a supercomputer. And so we speak the literature, and I'm probably playing this very soon with my colleagues, I did Python, and wrote the code, just scraped the websites and tried to figure all this out. And then when I went to Jack Shostak, the first thing he did was you have the wrong approach, which I should have listened to one of my biochemistry friends because he told me it was wrong. What they do is they don't really hydrogen out. They would take the 5 elements of our post-sample, and then they populate every, you write all the sample comments, or at least you're going through all possible combinations, and then you stick the hydrogens on afterwards. So he said, well, it's not just that, it's just in a very narrow area. And he was able to come up with a counter argument, like a counter molecule. So my theory was that life produces all small molecules, as far as you can go. And that this is incredible because for life on Earth, I don't know what it means, but it may mean that life is evolved in pathways with the biochemical elements. And that is something we're still working on, actually. It turns out I think there's something really awesome there, and we're working on that in my spare time, usually the summertime. But the thing it meant to me for exoplanets was that just like we've seen for the types of planets out there, the masses, the sizes, and types, just even for molecules, it really could be anything. I already gave you the example of the Earth's atmosphere. Say robustly right now, that really many, many different types of molecules could be produced. And so we want to make sure that whatever spectrograph we're making in the future for our space telescope, we really are capable of finding that molecules that we don't necessarily predict in advance. So in the research we already find, we don't really know what other life will produce. It seems like life on Earth produces a vast array of molecules. We want to be ready for it. Okay, so that concludes my talk, and I'm just going to give you a summary of what I talked about. First, I talked about the types of planets out there, and I tried to leave with you that there are so many planets we couldn't have imagined. No one ever predicted the fact that small planets the size of Neptune's or Earth's are far more common than Jupiter-sized planets. I talked about the hot Earth stuff, and I talked about compact multiple planet systems. And then I moved on to the habitable planets, and I warned you not to take too seriously the news whenever you hear that another habitable planet has been found. We don't have enough information yet. All we know is the mass and size and maybe how much light is leaving. Then I move on to how will we find a planet, the real search for alien life. The first thing is to look for planets that are rocky within atmospheres that are the right temperature. We're going to do that with a test James Webb combination. And then I move on to the concept of the real Earth twin. How are we going to find that? And I picked my favorite way to do it, which is the starshade telescope system. And I explained to you the big screen and the session shaped in the sky to walk at the starlight. And the final point I left you with is about biosymmetry gases and how really we're just beginning to scrape the surface. Find out all the different types of gases that life can produce. So in closing, I hope I've convinced you that the real search is going on. And we've only just begun. We have a huge momentum now, and we're definitely going to be here for that. Thank you.